Thank you. Good afternoon. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Amar Prabhu for inviting me to come here. When I look around in the room, I'm the only guy which has very narrow mandate, one crop, okay? So everybody has very broad and other things. But so I added on the title rice in the prefix, you can see there. So I'm going to focus, I think that was expected, I'm going to focus on rice. Okay, just to show the trend in rice production, what I did is I took fixed the yield in early 60s and the one in the blue shows if yield would have been fixed at 60s level, what would have been India's production versus the contribution of the yield or productivity over time. You can see the bulk of the production growth has come from the productivity growth or the yield growth there. Nothing unusual, nothing we didn't expect. Then just to give you a clear idea in terms of the production consumption gap trend there. So I took a 5-year moving average just to clear out some of the noises there. So you can clearly see India and the spread between per capita production and per capita consumption is increasing. So India is becoming a rice surplus country in the last 15 to 20 years. And that is very much reflected in their trade situations. India is the largest exporter of rice in the world for the last 3-4 years, pretty much the same table as Thailand. That's primarily why you see the gap between production and consumption there. Coming to the technology change and food security and poverty reduction, this is the work in progress. So I have only one slide on that, but this will constitute bulk of the paper what I'm writing there. We are addressing this IRRI's contribution and the national system contribution to varietal improvements in India. It's very surprising that this has never been done for India, primarily because there is no data available in India, varietal adoption over time series data or acreage under different varieties there. So what we did, we have been trying to create this series going back to state level breeder seed production data. So it has taken us a while. So we have the data right now from 1966 to 2015 breeder seed production by state. So the things what I have put here, I'll have similar graph for national system. I'll have a graph at the state level, each state level, and the contributions to the improvement there. So you can see this is just a sample. In India, 1,081 variety have been released in the last between 66 and 2015. Nearly 50% can be linked to IRRI germplasm. Remember, this is pretty much what's on the paper. What we are doing right now is we are collecting the seed samples. We have already collected it. So we are doing the DNA fingerprinting to verify whether the claims are, you know, what's written in the paper is correct or not. Just to give you an example, the DNA fingerprinting done by a previous project, we found out MTU1010. This is a very popular variety in India. Quite a bunch of it exported. It's a parboiled rice. It's nothing but IR64. So there is nothing in the literature which says, MTU1010 is IR64. There is not much difference between NK-Sing did that actually. So we are doing the DNA fingerprinting to verify what's on the paper there. Out of the 50% that can be linked to IRRI germplasm, IR8 alone, accounts for 252. So nearly a quarter of variety released in India can be linked to IR8 as a parent or grandparent or, you know, so there's some linkage there. So when you take all these things and we're focused on IRRI's contribution in the last 50 years, this is average. You can see nearly quarter of the area can be linked to IRRI germplasm in terms of the productions, values, 14 million ton additional production per year and 2.8 billion. This is just average. But just look at the slide on the right. If you see the bar there, you can see IRRI's contribution on the decline. Okay? And more importantly, if you look at last 20, 30 years, lot of this IRRI impact is through the variety release in 60s, 70s, 80s. So if I don't include that in the last 20, 25 years, it is impact only a lot lesser than what I've put there. So in the paper, we'll talk a lot about those things and kind of disaggregate at the state level and link it to the food security and the poverty reduction, which I don't have it right now. Also, the contribution of the national system there. So what I'm going to focus for the rest of the presentation is to talk about the technology change happening right now in the ground and the issues with the technology on the ground there. This is an example of what IRRI, India, China, the lot of other scientists around the world working to transform rice from C3 to C4 crop. So if at all they become successful, which they're expecting in somewhere in the 30s, we can see a big jump in the yield. So it's a big genetic gains. If at all we are successful, this is what we have modeled using the crop model. It's under review with the food security report. Now you can see, on average, you will see a jump of 30% yield gains in South Asia, primarily in the, you can see with fertilization, CO2 fertilization, that's without fertilization there. But bulk of IRRI efforts, efforts of breeders in India also, in the last probably two decades, they have pretty much focused on breeding specific traits. So initially it was genetic gains, then went from genetic gains to maintenance breeding, they call it. They fix certain things as it arises. Now it has gone into last 20 years to specific traits. So trait could be biotic, abiotic, certain consumer quality, those type of things. But what I'm going to focus is mostly on the abiotic stress for this presentation there. And within the abiotic stress, I'm going to focus on the flood tolerant, because that's where the most visible right now among all the STR varieties on the ground there. Just look at India. There are many sub-1 variety, which is the flood tolerant varieties, released in last 8-9 years, 7-8 years. The most prominent is one the sub-1. Now in the last few years, Sambamasuri sub-1, IR64 sub-1. Then most recently, the Bina Dhan, that's the Bangladesh flood tolerant varieties that was released in eastern India or Odisha or east part of eastern India as part of the Strasa agreement, where the variety released in India, Bangladesh and Nepal can be released in another country using the field data collected by the country. So to reduce the time gap of releasing one variety from one country to another there. About the sub-1 there, I think there are quite a bit of studies already done. This is the finding of the RCT trial done between IRRI and Berkeley folks there, which is very robust in terms of what sub-1 is doing at the farmer's level. What they're finding is the flood tolerant variety sub-1 reduces the yield variability and raises expected yield. And more importantly, it's benefiting the socially disadvantaged people, because the people called Scheduled Caste, Scheduled Tribe, they are the one whose land is in the flood prone area, in the unfavorable area there, and they are the one supposed to get the maximum benefits out of sub-1 adoption there. Then there's another paper just came out by the same group, Berkeley and IRRI folks, which came out in the AER, American Economic Review. Which the gist of the finding is that the adoption of the tolerant varieties, sub-1, actually altering the management practices. I think it's very common sense. If you reduce this risk, the farmers alter the management practices, which they used to be risk averse earlier. But it's very important, because initially we thought there's impact of yield saving yield loss, but now there's impact of yield gains due to change in the management practice. That was not quite evident, or even farmers even don't know that. That's we are getting there. Then the another survey looking at the average annual additional income from sub-1 adoptions, around $78 per acre during the years when there is flood there, and how they spend the money there. These are all from the same RCT trial, other surveys done in Odisha particularly. But thing is, you got all these benefits of sub-1 there. You would wonder, Everybody in eastern India who are in the flood zone area, by this time must be growing sorghum. You know, that was pretty evident that this is a sound technology and it will move very fast on the ground, based on even what we see at all the RCTs saying same thing. But when we did the household survey, this is a very large survey, around 6,000 farmers in India, in four states where sorghum being disseminated. It's being done for last 3 years, 2013, 14, 15. So when we find out how many people are actually growing sorghum, I'm not sure I can say adopted. It's a lot less than what we estimated using the seed production data. Based on the seed production data, breeder seed intent, actual seed production, it should be somewhere around 5 million hectares, nearly 5 million farmers growing sorghum. Okay? So when we look here, you can see the total sorghum, a total acreage under sorghum is 400,000. And if you look at last 3 years, it hasn't gone anywhere. Kind of stagnant. Okay, so it was very, it's puzzling to people what is happening. You know, if you do all these RCTs, the farmers talk about all these benefits, but when we see the ground level data, it doesn't match with what the RCT is saying there. Here is the adoption puzzle. You have usual culprits, credit, market, insurance, policy, you know, nothing we can change at our level. But what mistake we made is, remember there is a sorghum fits in a certain environment. This is not a mega variety like IR64 or IR8, IR72, where you can just push it anywhere and getting adopted there. So we didn't have the knowledge. We are very improper technology targeting. Okay, in the last 7-8 years, we pushed the varieties to the national systems. A national system pushed it through the extension system, then there's incorrect information given to farmers regarding the variety. Very important. If you talk to farmers growing sorghum, they have absolutely no idea why they're growing it. They're growing it because they think it's a new variety, and as a new variety, they should be getting higher yield than what they're growing right now. Sorghum is supposed to give same yield in the non-flooded year. So you get the yield advantage during the flooded season there. So farmers, if you are not faced with flood, which is normally on average once in 3 years, they disadopt before they see the benefits of that. So we see some of this puzzle happening on the ground. Then the fourth one, since remember we pushed through the national system, we don't have the capacity, a lot of incorrect labeling of seed. So when we did the survey, we also collected the seed sample from 20% of the households, and we did the DNA fingerprinting, particularly in India. The results not public yet. Nearly half of the farmers telling it wrong. In a sense, they are not growing sorghum, but they're saying that's a sorghum because they got it as a sorghum, either through NFSM or BGRI. Remember NFSM, BGRI, these are the two big programs you talked about. They only can disseminate seeds which is 10 years or younger. And Swarna sorghum is one of the approved varieties. So the extension people push it, Puja, Lalad, other varieties are sorghum, where farmers think they're growing sorghum, but they're not growing there. So it is some very interesting findings why it hasn't moved as far as we would have thought based on the soundness of the particular technology there. This is just to give example. This is sorghum. This is in Assam, where we think the Swarna sorghum would fit, with a flood of less than 10 days, probably much better for sorghum, but rather than going for 21 days and above. So you have to be very, very careful where you are disseminating or what you are telling the farmers. So it has to go to the right place, you know, right time and right information. Then only you see adoption taking place. Otherwise, you see a disadoption taking place there. So what we're doing right now is, remember this is a variety which doesn't have a genetic gains, because on the normal year it grows, the yield is same as others. It only see the benefits when there's a flood there. So what we did, what we're doing right now is we're trying to package it with other things. I'll give you two examples. The new strategy we are taking out so that the adoption takes place. So this particular is a Vietnamese model. I've kind of modified. I'm leading this one in Odisha right now. This is not a farmers producers company. This is a synchronization of activities. Okay, this is still the small farm, but we're synchronizing the activities. I'll tell you how we have done it. So it's a horizontal consolidation of the small farmers. So everybody is still the same. There is no land consolidation happening. They're just organized as a group. To increase the bargaining power, both input-output market. Then there's a vertical integration in terms of the input dealers, millers, and other things there. Just to tell you what I have done there, this is in Bhubaneswar. This is the season. We are starting it. For this dry season there, we have 58 farmers. We have an 8-member committee. The area plays 104 acres, nearly one patch. And the farmers unanimously decided to grow Bina Dhan 11. That's a sub-1 varieties, but the primary side is at a higher market price. Also, they can save the seed for the wet season there. So far, what we have done, our intervention is to provide them the quality seed. So we, through our projects, they bought it, but we have provided making sure that this is Bina Dhan 11, the one they picked. But also, we have facilitated some of the synchronization activities you can see there. IFCO providing fertilizer at a wholesale price. The millers more or less drooling over the opportunity to buy because this is single varieties. That's the only catch here. The farmers used to grow everybody's own variety. There's a lot of variety mix. So they're willing to pay premium because there's single variety there. So we are having a bidding in terms of which miller gets it. Whatever the market price, they give a slightly higher than that. Then the single contract to the service provider, either it's a mechanical transplanter or a combined harvest, the contract is single. And the transplanting, harvesting, they will all kind of synchronize there. This is just to give example, the group, we have 100 acres, the nursery bed only 7 places. So the largest one is 30 acres nursery bed there. And just the benefits they got from the nursery bed preparation, farmers were amazed. Before, each farmer used to have this small nursery bed. They used to call tractor. The tractor cannot move in that very small area where the nursery bed you prepare. The tractor guys has to move from one place to another to do it. Now he completes this work in 3 days, rather than he used to take 27 days because of timing or the things there. So this is the largest patch of the nursery bed in there. Remember, all this behind is the Bina Dhan 11. That's a sub-1 variety we are trying to push. Okay. This is the cost savings. I don't have to go through. You can see each activity, we get a saving because of the group farming there, or group decision making there. Fertilizer, seed nursery, land preparation, mechanical transplanting, combined harvest. These are all been negotiated in terms of saving what they used to give and what they're giving now. So we are expecting 25% higher yield. It's pretty obvious that we give them a quality seed. We are doing transplanting, timely transplanting, timely harvesting, uniform crop. So you expect higher yield. So they used to have 2 tons per acre in the last rabi season. Now we are assuming, or we're thinking 2.5 is very conservative estimates, considering there is no risk because it's all irrigated area there. We talked to the millers. They're basically agreeing to pay 3,000 rupees more than what the prevailing market price would be at that time. So bottom line is we're basically doubling their income or the profit from what they had last rabi season versus this rabi season. We think if we wrap our tolerant varieties, which doesn't have visible gains to the farmers or benefits. This way, you might accelerate the adoption process versus if you have a variety of genetic gains. Pretty obvious, farmers see the benefits and moves to the thing. The another thing what we're doing, I'm going to 2 examples there. The second is wrapping these stress-tolerant varieties. Remember, stress-tolerant variety means you have low risk in terms of losing your crop. With yield insurance there, okay? That's part of the Government of India initiative, the area yield coverage there. So we have the technology in terms of estimating, forecasting yield using satellite data there. So basically, we have last 6 years, we have developed the systems where rice is grown and how much yield forecast and estimates there at a resolution of 20 by 20 using INSAT 1A, 1B data there. This is the process where how the yield estimation process is done. I can skip that. Just to tell you, you get update 40 days after transplanting, every 12 days, you get update on area and the yield there, and it changes as the weather or other things changes there. Here is the advantage of using this versus crop cutting, from both from insurer perspective and also, is that my time?
Yeah.
Okay.
Or from the
smallholder perspective. You can see there, if you're an insurer, you're using this one, you get a mid-season information, you get a flood map, flood damage, you get regular crop portfolio monitoring, target field-based monitoring, then from the farmer perspective, more timely payout. We can provide the yield yield estimates 15 days after harvesting, versus crop cutting take up to 8 months for the payout to comes, and a higher transparency on loss and yield assessment. So there could be a provision of early payout. If there's a germination loss, you don't have to wait until the harvesting takes place. You can have an early payout if you know exactly the extent of the germination loss there. Now, this particular technology, it's just not in research right now. Tamil Nadu, after 6 years of field trial, around 40,000 field validation data, the Tamil Nadu recently approved, the insurance committee approved to use this technology for the crop insurance. This is the first season they are doing it. The Odisha is in progress. Then we have Andhra, Telangana, and Assam in the next 12 months. So we are pushing it. One thing, we link it to our stress-tolerant varieties to the insurance company. If the farmer growing stress-tolerant varieties, you can reduce the premium a little bit, because there's less risk now losing the crop due to the unfavorable climate there. So these are two examples of how we are approaching in terms of, we have many of the varieties coming out, and on the pipeline is basically a specific threat, either flood, drought, or some of the biotic stress, or some of the consumer's quality. So it's not very obvious for the farmers, unless you wrap it around with certain packages and make it attractive for the farmers to adopt it. So this is what I have. If you're breeding for either genetic gains or versus traits, most of the current technology in the pipeline addressing the specific traits. So you need to make sure your precise technology targeting strategy. You cannot just randomly distribute everywhere. Make sure provision of the farmers, information to the farmers. Farmers know exactly what this is, where the benefits coming from. And then the extension systems become critical for the adoption to take place. This is where we have missed in terms of sub one. And wrap it with other technology and enabling factors. With improved management, that includes crop establishment, mechanizations, insurance, the two examples I have given there. Although ideally, if you can have a varieties sub one with genetic gains, then the adoption becomes a lot easier than what you would have seen there. Thank you.